see Miss Jane before you leave tonight and give her your cell phone number, or Miss Leslie's got it. And I'm guessing he wants to start building a database for himself so he can text you and keep up with you and put out mass text for information and stuff like that. So see Miss Leslie before you leave tonight and give her that information. All right? Everybody excited to meet you? Y'all look excited, okay? All right. Where's Carly? Carly's not here?
No.
Oh, I was going to pick on her to start with. Everybody knows Carly likes plenty of food, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't think anybody likes plenty of food as much as Carly does. But, you know, everybody likes plenty of food, but nobody likes Eeyore much, do they? Somebody else, you know, Tom Cruise? That's older than some of you. Okay. Look it up on Facebook. It's there. Look up You Complete Me, Tom Cruise, and you'll see it. But the whole thing, you know, he's a sports agent. But it's a typical love story where, you know, she falls for him and he dumps on her and then he tries to win her back. And this signature scene in the movie is he goes over to her house and knocks on the door, she opens the door, and there's some family in there, different stuff, and he starts just pouring his heart out, you know, saying, you know, that I'm sorry. And the way he does it is he is as serious as he is. You complete me. And she says, shut up. Just shut up. And he looks at her like, oh, no. And that's when she goes, you had me at hello. You know, and it's the other day, you know. And so anyway, if that's what your purpose in life, and I need to go back to the room here. If that's your purpose in life, to say to somebody else, you complete me, we've got a problem. Now, a better scene in this, how many of you seen The Dark Knight? Because Joker takes off on that. Y'all remember that? Do you remember that scene in The Dark Knight? When Batman says, well, why are you trying to kill me? And Joker says, kill you? I'm not trying to kill you. What would I do without you? You complete me. You know, that's where that line came from. Anyway, I'm way off base here. But don't you see how that's flawed, that you are giving the keys to your life and your happiness and your joy and your purpose to somebody else? I mean, so, and that's not what I want to focus on tonight, but that's, I kind of want to lay the groundwork for why that just doesn't work. And really, if you want to understand your purpose, okay, and I'm saying, don't make your purpose about somebody else. Well, okay, well, then what else can it be? Well, then maybe I need to pursue the things of the world. Maybe I need to pursue money. Maybe I need to pursue status. You know, maybe I need to pursue these other things. Why is that working out for you? You know, if that would work, then why is the world not full of happy people? Because that's certainly what we're after. So, where do we start? What does God's Word say about that? And if we want to understand our purpose, what better place to go than the one who created us? Don't you think He knows what our purpose is? And if we want to know that, then we need to go back to the beginning of when it happened. So open your Bibles to the book of Genesis. We're going to spend, you know, a lot of time in there, and we're going to just kind of look through that. And through the creation story, we find our purpose. Through that creation story, we can find, why was I created? What is the meaning of life? Why am I here? It's in God's creation. It's in the story of creation. You know, and so we got to understand that life is not always fair. You know, life is not always easy. Life is not always about happiness. Life is not always all the cherries. But if we live life like God created us to live it, it'll be complete, it'll be abundant, and it'll be glorious. So if that appeals to you, if you've ever asked that question of, why am I here? Why? Well, you know, my life has no purpose. If you've ever said those things, we must look to what God's Word says about why we were created. So if you want to know your purpose, you've got to go back to the beginning. So Genesis chapter 1, let's kind of set the stage here. Now we've been through, you know, more than 6 days God has been about creating the universe. You know, He makes all these things, night and day and light, and He, you know, separates things and creates things and speaks and things come into being and, you know, just establishes all this stuff. And near the end of that 6th day, you know, it says, and God said this, and God said that, and when God said it, it happened. But then in verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Well, who is us? When God said us, who's He talking about? Well, some people would say, well that's, He's talking about angels, you know, and us. Well, no, but nothing in the Bible ever says that we're created in the image of angels. We're created in the image of God. Well, maybe this is His heavenly court, you know. Well, nothing in the Bible Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us make man in our image. And so that's what he's talking about there. You know, and then he says, let him have dominion. What does that mean? It means we're in charge of. Let man be over all of the rest of this creation. We'll touch on that a little bit later. You know, and most people believe that when he says, create us in our image, what is the image of God really mean? What does it mean to be created in the image of God? You know, if God says, let us make man, then God himself is a relational being. The Trinity, three in one. Something that we really can't explain, but it is just there, and there are many references to it in the Bible you can find. But by definition, God is a relational being, so when we're created in the image of God, then we're relational beings, and we'll touch on that a little bit more in a second. But most people believe when he says, created in the image of God, he's talking about those things that set us apart. And why are we different than the animals and the other things that God created? You know, we can reason things through. You know, we have morality, we understand right and wrong. You know, some of those things are what means to be created in the image of God. Question. Those of you that play sports, when you go to away games, does the coach still make you dress up? I like to dress up, especially in basketball season. I mean, you go marching into the other team's gym with just tie on. Why do they make you do that? Because, and I'm sure you've heard it, because you're a representative of your school, right? You know, and your conduct, your behavior, your appearance is supposed to represent your school. That's what it means to be created in the image of God. Everything we say, now think about what this means. Everything we say, everything we do, the way we carry ourselves, because we're created in the image of God, it reflects on you. So what is the purpose of our life? Then by definition, we're created to glorify Him. You know, talking about mankind in the book of Isaiah, God says this about man, whom I created for my glory. If you want to know why you were created, He says it right there, for my glory. The thing is,